7 o'clock, and I'm calling the meeting to order. This is our regular meeting, Tuesday, March the 7th, 2017. And I'd like to welcome everyone here, and thank you all for coming to see about the city's business. And the prayer will be given to us by Pastor Chris Hillier from the First Baptist Church.
Came on and read that. Just one scripture verse with it. Proverbs 11:11. By the blessing of the upright, the city is exalted. Lord, we thank you for this day that you have given us. We thank you for the life that you have given us. Every breath that we breathe, every step that we take, every thought that we have is because of you giving us life. I pray for each and every one here tonight, for all our leaders in our community. Pray, God, that you will give them wisdom, that you will guide them as they seek to bless our city, our community, our county, to exalt it. Yes. We just pray, God, that you will continue to unite and bring us together. Yes. Lord, my prayer is that the laws of our land, the desires and will of the people, and most importantly, your commands, Lord, guide them and lead them on how to run things, give vision for things, make decisions, all that is brought before them. The weight is a heavy weight, and they need your supernatural strength through your Holy Spirit, your Holy Word, and the support of the people in this community. Yes. We're diverse, a lot of different ideas, beliefs, and backgrounds. But Lord, I know that we can all come together and with respect and civility, enjoy this great community, and I pray you'll guide them in how to make the decisions that are best for all that that live here. We thank you for Brooks County and Quitman, and we thank you for the life you give us. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 Thank you. If we all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. May I see you. Before we get to the adoption of the agenda, I believe there's I know of two issues, there may be more. The American Red Cross sent over a proclamation, and I reviewed it, but I would just like to put it before the council first. So it's going to be D under city managers, the American Red Cross proclamation. And because C before that is to discuss the protocol for the city proclamations. And Ms. Nadine Proctor is here.
Right.
Okay, and you would like to address us on your
alcohol beverage license.
Okay, and that would be who would you like for that?
C under appointments.
Okay, that would be under C under appointments. Not, is there a motion to adopt the agenda with the addendums that were just added?
I'll make that motion.
I'm sorry. I have one question first. I looked at the call meeting, and I just want to make sure this, that in the approval of the minutes, the call meeting, it says January the 27th, but only so we didn't say it's the 23rd.
week that is on the 23rd. Because we had it on a Thursday, if I remember right.
Well, do you remember?
Let me go to my office, I can verify real quick.
Okay, yes.
I think it was on the 23rd.
Yes, sir, that was the 23rd.
It was the 23rd. Okay, well, we had to strike the 27th on there. It will be January the 23rd. So is there a motion to adopt the agenda as presented with the corrections and additions?
I'll make that motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. All opposed? Did you get it? This is Brandon opposed. But the motion passes. All right. Number 6 on the agenda is the approval of the minutes. That will be A, the call meeting minutes for January the 23rd, 2017, and B, the regular meeting minutes, February the 7th, 2017. Is there a motion to approve these minutes as presented?
So moved.
Is there a second?
A second.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous, thank you. Number 7. The appointments, and A would be Mr. Scott Rotz, home from the Bruce County Library, but he had somewhere else to be, so we're going to skip over that. And B is the economic developer, the update from Mrs. Tiffany Holmes.
Hello, thank you for allowing me to be here tonight. Wanted to make you guys aware that the way that the schedule has ended up working out, I was able to attend the November meeting, I was at a conference in December, I was able to attend the January meeting at a conference in February, so here I am at the March meeting, so it looks like it's going to be probably about an every other month thing, unless I've got some sort of training or something that comes up. So that's why I make sure that I email you guys as frequently as we have information that I think that you need to know. So I try to make sure that I update my board, the city, and the county as often as possible. So to get to some of the things that we've had going on, I'm going to knock you with my paper here. We did celebrate Camellia Week, and that was information that I presented to you at the last, at the January meeting. But that was an incredibly successful week for us. We were able to host various events, but all the events that we sold tickets to were all sold out events. So we had good participation, good turnout, and I think that it was just good for the city and the community as a whole to continue to brand ourselves as the Camellia City. So we will work on that again next year, but we've got a while before we do that. Next, wanted you to know about some of the downtown projects that we're working on. We had the sidewalks pressure washed in the month of February. It took two different Sundays to get it all done. There was a lot of cleaning to be done. So I think that most of the business owners are pleased. We had one issue that Michael contacted me about, and we got that resolved that same day. So we tried to make sure that we did something good and we did something beneficial, and then if there were any issues, hopefully, to the best of my knowledge, we took care of them immediately. And everyone is very happy, as far as I'm aware. We are working on developing banners. I actually spent a good bit of time today working on that. Banners for our downtown and hopefully South Court Street, as long as I can stretch the money far enough. But I'd like to have banners that would carry us throughout the summer, so something that's patriotic, but that's also just summer friendly. We'd like to have another set that we put up in the holiday season, so November or December, but we've not really begun working on those designs yet, but we're really close on finishing up the ones for the summer. So I'm really, really excited about the way that those are turning out. We're working with Mr. Ragsdale and Michael and Bruni and everyone to get some information to update the skyline lights in our downtown. At the meeting that I was here before, you guys requested that I contact the city of Tifton to see what grant they had received to be able to fund that project. It does not look like that's something that we're going to be able to pursue, but we are trying to get a cost estimate in place because the development authority would like to come to the table potentially with that money. So once we get the information about that, there's a file somewhere between here and Walker Street School that contains all the information about the company that we used the last time, the cost involved. So we're tracking that down, and once we get that, we'll be able to get a cost estimate in place. Some other things that we're working on, of course, are updating our Christmas lights, our Christmas decorations that we have, and working on some marketing and some posters like the Thomasville Scene magazine does once a year, a feature on downtown Quitman, so we're working on designing that ad for downtown Quitman now. We've worked with Michael and with the council to increase the trash pickup in downtown. So instead of it being just once a week, now it's twice a week. And I was just looking at one of the cans downtown thinking maybe it needs to be three times a week because there's just so much trash. But I get to work every morning and walk outside with a bag and pick things up. And so hopefully we'll just encourage everyone to just kind of pick up around them, and we'll be able to make a good positive effort in that manner. Also working on a plan to replant the planters in downtown, the big concrete planters that we have. There's trash and cigarette butts in them right now, so we want to get that cleaned up. I'd really like to have it cleaned up in time for summer. Like to have the new banners go up, new planters, and just make it look really nice for all the visitors that are going to be traveling through downtown. I've submitted an article to Ms. Bonnell that recaps all of that information, and I also shared that with you all late last week, Thursday or Friday, I emailed it to you. Another thing that I'm going to be doing beginning Thursday, I'm going to begin my coursework to become a Georgia Certified Economic Developer. So that will take 2 to 3 years depending on how often I can get to the training. So it's a lengthy process, but I think that it's going to benefit our community in the long run. So I will be going once every few months to classes, so it's not going to be a tremendous amount of time out of the office, thankfully. But just wanted y'all to know that that's something I'm working on. And also, the big happy news is that Thursday, mid-morning, we are expecting the governor to release an announcement about our Project X in the industrial park, which is going to be 100 jobs and an $18 million investment for our community. So it will be our first project in the industrial park, and I am thrilled. So if you hear me screaming on Thursday, you'll know that that's what it's about. So I will push that information out as soon as it gets to me. I have seen the press release, but I'll wait for the official one to come out from the governor's office. And after that, then I'll do a full recap for Ms. Bonnell in the Quitman Free Press. So, are there any questions?
Well, I'd like to say thank you. Keep up the good work.
Yes, sir.
I
know. As I was sitting here for this meeting, I got another request for information about a company for the industrial park. So, I truly feel like it's going to be one of those things where we land one and it starts to get some attention for our park. And I failed to mention while I was going through everything, I'm sure that you all have received a package with these. If not, I'll leave these and I have more. But the state of Georgia established a Camellia Trail, and I am happy to say that even though we are not the state of Georgia's official Camellia City, we think we are, so we're just going to go with it. So we have either 5 or 6 stops on this map, and other communities have 1, 2, maybe 3, so we really take up a lot of space, and I think that it's just continuing to push. This is who we are, this is what we're proud of. So I will leave these here, but we're front and center right in the middle when you open it up. So
thank you very much.
I'll leave those there.
Appreciate
any questions, call me, text me.
Thank you. Does anyone have any questions for Mrs. Holmes? Thank you very much and keep up the good work. And if, whenever you finish with it, whatever it is you had presented or you were here for, you can leave those stage.
I might take you up on that because I have kids with homework.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Okay. C would be Miss Nadine Proctor.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. I came today because I was very much disturbed because the simple reason that I was trying to get my alcohol license, which I had paid for, and to find out that this detail here from the Department of Revenues was supposed to be given to me as a guide when I had purchased the liquor license. However, for some unknown reason, I've had it for 2 years, and no one ever told me that I had to call Atlanta to be given the initial documents and available for the state of Georgia tax registration of a copy of the license. So I asked the young lady about releasing my alcohol beverage license. She refused to release it. And then she yelled and said, "You haven't paid your taxes." Well, I didn't know that you had to call Atlanta, Georgia in order to get the details. So today, by all means, she gave me the papers, which she should have been given to me during the time that I had purchased the alcohol license. And as the retail dealer says that the requires a document available, the state of Georgia tax registration, a copy of the local license, if the local license has not been received prior to applying for the state license, a copy of the application for the local license, or a letter from the local license authority stating that the application has been received and may be uploaded during the initial process. No one never did that, but today she tried to do that, and she put it in here, and I don't think I should be punished. I don't think I should be embarrassed, yelling all out the window, telling me I got to pay taxes, and she's not going to give me my license. Well, I paid for them, and I would like to have this letter inserted and given to anyone that comes to get alcohol and beverages, so they would know the proper guide when they do purchase license what to do. I was very much misinformed. No one was cooperating with me. There's nothing wrong with me. And I was very much embarrassed. And I would like you to have this letter inserted in everyone who come to get their alcohol and beverages, that they may know the proper rules and regulation in owning an alcohol and beverage license. Thank you.
You're welcome, Mrs. Parker.
The doctor came a few weeks ago and asked about alcohol license. At that time, she was a drive-through window, and I informed her that I needed a copy of her state license. Sparked after a brief conversation, went on, and I assumed she knew what I was talking about. Today, she visited and to pay her utility bill. She was asking about the license, and as I informed her, it's not our responsibility to make sure she has all of her licenses as required by the Department of Revenue, or what I'm here to do is to make sure that the city's information, in part, what we are requiring, that's the information I can do. This is something that should have been brought to her attention by her accountant or whoever's doing whatever it is. This is not something that I am liable for, let's put it this way. So that's the conversation that we have.
Okay. That's it?
Sure.
Okay. Are you wanting to make a...
No, I was just requesting that possibly there is more information added to the process of getting the alcohol license, to where in the future, you know, there is a tutorial for all the steps for an individual. So if they do approach the city will be able to provide each step, all the information, so we don't have a situation like this. I think it'd be helpful.
Exactly.
Okay, well, I can tell you something from signing quite a few licenses. And they're called occupation business license.
This is not occupation license, alcohol license. I mean, you would have to.
Yes. Well, no, I'm just let me finish. And what happens is we just make sure that the person has done everything that they're supposed to have done. Like, if you wanted to open up a daycare and you came up here with like half the paperwork, that's not the city's fault. I mean,
I'm not trying to push any blame. I'm just saying extra assistance is all I'm saying.
Well, you'd have to, the staff would have to look at that and see if they would approve that, because, you know, someone might want something else. And as I said, it's not the city's responsibility to make sure that the person comes up here with everything that they need.
The paper stipulates that the local office is supposed to give the support. It stipulates that.
Okay. Well, hold on a second.
Okay.
Is there a problem with this, or you have to look into that first?
We can look and see what's on the license and talk to Mr. Gerald and find out what we can put on the license as far as a detailed checklist or something like that.
Yes.
We'll check into it.
Thank you,
guys. All right, yes, ma'am. We're not here to argue with you.
No, I don't want to argue.
We're trying to work through things.
I don't want to argue with no one. This is an idea. I just want to correct for the next person.
Okay.
All right,
so,
thank you.
That's the answer to your question?
Yes, it is.
All right, thank you, Mrs. Brock.
Thank you.
All righty. Roman number 8 is old business. A is discussion and motion to approve the resolution 295-17 to submit the CDBG Community Development Block Grant for the Immediate Threat and Danger Grant for some work that has already been done, correct? Okay.
This is kind of like a formality, Mayor. I know the council has already approved applying for it, but we didn't do a resolution to that effect at the time, and the application from BCA requires a resolution. So,
what exactly is this now?
This is for an immediate threat and danger grant for the repair work we did on well number 3 whenever it went down. It cost us about $33,000, so the grant would pay up to half of that as a reimbursement.
So that's the one under the, on the corner, all the buildings on the corner, right? What is?
No, that's the one.
The other one.
Right.
Okay. All right, y'all. I'm just going to read it. We don't have to, but I just would like the public to know what it is. Resolution number 295-17 of the City of Quitman to submit an application to obtain Community Development Block Grant Immediate Threat and Danger Program funds. Whereas the City of Quitman has identified a lack of sufficient funds to address an immediate need for water system improvements, specifically pump replacement at the Forsyth Street well, and whereas Community Development Block Grant Immediate Threat and Danger Program funds are sufficient to address this need, and whereas the City of Quitman has requested the staff of the Southern Georgia Regional Commission to assist in the preparation of the CDBG Immediate Threat and Danger Program application to make an emergency replacement of the pump at the Forsyth Street well. Whereas the City of Quitman has agreed to provide sufficient matching funds and in-kind services to complete this project, therefore be it resolved that the City of Quitman will submit a CDBG Immediate Threat and Danger Program application to address the identified needs. So resolved this 7th day of March 2017, signed by me. All right, is there a motion to approve Resolution 295-17?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous, thank you. B, the discussion and motion to purchase financial and utility billing software. And we were given some paperwork.
If I may, Mayor, I want to speak on this. Mike, I talked about how to best present. It's just a lot of information that we have on this. If any of the council members want to see the notes, the information that I have, it's available. The demonstrations, they all had their pros and cons. After reviewing and looking at everything, it is my opinion that Edmunds, the number one that is on there, is the best software. And the reason for that is it is a scalable software. If we were to decide not to go with everything from the get-go, we could always easily add on. If we wanted to switch from on-site to off-site or vice versa, we could easily do that. It was a very clear and concise software. All the windows looked and felt the same, so if you find your way around one section, you know how to operate the other. It's very detailed when it comes to distributions of the billing, distributions of salaries, which some of the lower cost ones do not have that option. Let's say you have an employee that works in two different departments, 50-50, you would actually have to issue two checks, which the IRS doesn't like that too much. I'm surprised we have not done things on that. Some of the other things were Edmunds, within Edmunds, it's not a separate software that has to be purchased. It's a link to an online payment system. It's a link to where in a small module is where people can actually look at their billing online if they wanted to. They have apps, and it's all within one software, whereas others that we've seen, such as Thomasville, the utility billing site was written by Thomasville, but then we would have to purchase three or four different softwares in addition to get the same effect. And as you all know, South Georgia Regional Commission, which we've taken into consideration as well, they're at the beginning stages of rewriting the current software, which we're using. I've learned early on, when you're in computers, you learn early on, you know, you don't ever want to buy a version one of anything when it comes to software. You want to have experienced software, so all the bugs and kinks are out. So with that said, Edmunds is the front runner. We have the option to do on-site, meaning we have the database here, or we have access to the database off-site. If you have on-site, there's additional things that have to happen, such as nightly backups, off-site storage. You want to make sure you have a good antivirus software, anti-Trojan, and that type of deal. So there's an IT agreement would have to go along with that, where we would have to do probably a request for proposals at that point. So based on that, depending on what the outcome is of the cost of that, we would depend if we were to go off-site or on-site. The off-site has one downfall: if the internet goes down, we have no access. With that being said, we have off-site now, and it's very rare we go offline. Our internet access, or our internet, is pretty reliable, and speed is pretty good. So if council were to approve it tonight, I would recommend to leave the onsite, offsite open until we know what the proposals would come back for the IT services.
I was I sat through all of these except for Smart Fusion, but I had sat through that when I worked with Cook County because that's who they have. But
that one's terrible.
I concur. I mean, Edmonds, I believe, is the one that would do us the most good. As she said, with South Georgia Regional Commission, with them doing away basically with the software we use now, it's inevitable we got to buy something. The last two on the list, you get what you pay for, and they weren't very good at all. Thomasville is a cheaper upfront cost, but you see a huge annual cost. And Edmonds, to me, would be the best, I think, for us. And if you remember, we had council had put back or approved $70,000, I think, last year to go towards software purchases. And then with the GFA loan that we're trying to get, we've actually included $60,000 in that can be used if we get approved for that loan to purchase this. And I've already talked to him, and he's talked to the software company, and they would work with us on the payment, so and we could get reimbursed if we had to do some upfront cost. So there won't be a lot of out-of-pocket expense, so to speak, like the number says, if we rope it into the loan account.
And this is going to give us some online capabilities?
Yeah, it'll give us, and it would mesh good with our AMI system, our metering system that we're trying to put in place where it automatically reads. There's a portal that citizens can sign up for, and they can go in there, view their account, pay online, all that kind of stuff with this type of software. It's going to be able to do all that.
And see, usage, if we were to go with that one type of metering that reads every day or hourly or whatever.
Now, is this going to eliminate a lot of the problems that we've been having with mailing of bills, some of the other kind of
types? Yes, because we won't have to rely, like right now we have to rely on the RDC to create our bills. With this software, it's created automatically by us. So that cuts down on 3 to 5 days worth of waiting on them and problems and all that.
Budget billing is
and
also
already,
an option.
We're already set up on with our folding system and our printer, so we've eliminated the print issue that was causing us some time. So with the additional cutting out the time that somebody else has to compile our bills for us, is going to help us streamline that even more. So.
And then this would also be compatible if we, well, when we eventually do the turnover for electric, when we upgrade the electric meter system, it'll be compatible.
Yeah, we made sure of that. As a matter of fact, I can't remember which city it is, but there's some cities already has that type metering system that uses this software. So.
And I spoke with the representative, and I said, what if we end up buying something that you all aren't prepared for? He said, regardless, if we do not have it, the code for it at this time, we will write the code. He said, but there's unless it's something really small that no one's ever heard of, we have all of the main players already, so.
And this, this system is already being used?
Several places. Matter of fact, Cockrell County uses it. That's probably the closest city or county that uses it. And they've been using it for years and love it. And then I think they said you talked with them, and there was two more cities that are going to Edmonds that were on some of the other
Smart Fusion, I think.
What about hardware upgrades for us?
We are going to have to do some hardware upgrades, and a lot of that is like Randy said, going to depend on if we house our information on-site versus off-site. There'll be some terminals and stuff like that we do have to upgrade, server and that extenuating hardware and stuff.
One of
the cost of that would depend on which way we go.
Right. Well, one of the things that was discussed in here before too was if we do, we want to get a server in here to back up data, documents, have an email address for everyone that is, that's the same at City of Quitman, as well as for our council members. So everybody works on the same thing. So that would, a server would allow that regardless. We will eventually recommend going with the server so we have some security there. Because right now, if something happens to my laptop, all that use of information and work goes out.
You'll have a backup?
I make a backup, but not everybody does it.
Yes, I have a question, a couple of questions actually.
Is it in reference to?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
The first question is, will the rate?
I'm sorry, could you state your name?
Oh, my name is Bill Holland. I'm a resident of Quitman. The first question is, will the rate change? First of all, I think that's the more important question for a citizen who pays the bills here. And then second of all, will the method of calculation change with the new system? I understand that the system may be outdated, but will it help the citizens who are, you know, who are paying this outrageous bill? Will it help them to pay their bill or to manage their bill? Because from my understanding, the method of calculation is just not. It's a compound rate calculation. It's just not proper.
It's standard, sir. I think that you and I spoke.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's standard as far as electric. It's a standard way of calculating. No matter which city you go to, you will not find a flat rate on.
Based off of the Georgia average, actually the Brooks County supposed to be average. Although it may be a standard method. It's about 50% more than what it would be if it was a flat rate.
And you're speaking about what in particular?
I'm speaking about the rate in which we're charged for our electricity, kilowatts per hour.
All right. You missed a couple of meetings that we had. But,
yes.
Well, we got some data from ECG or it was about. ECG, Electric Cities of Georgia. Mm-hmm. It used to be a part of EAG when they split up. And we are EAG. And Municipal Electrical Association of Georgia, something. Well, anyway, they gave us some comparable rates compared to other towns, Valdosta, Thomasville, and I don't have a copy of that with me. But if you look at that, it's what you're saying, we are comparable.
Well, I don't refute that.
Okay.
But, yes, ma'am, go ahead.
I think, just to make sure that may I clarify, Mr. Holman and I spoke, he wanted to know how we come up with this figure. And I think what the question is, because it's the first 25 kilowatts, it's
right.
Built into the base
right,
fee.
Right.
Then your next step is the next 100 is
100,
charged
right.
at 0.7 cents,
right.
whatever. The next 300 are charged at
right.
a lower rate, at
right.
0.6
right.
something.
From
and then the next scale. One
right, yeah,
is
yeah.
at a 0.4 something, I think. And I think that is where Mr. Holman is, that's what you're asking
yes.
about.
Mm-hmm.
Because he said compound. So once you go into the next category, you're released from the first one, right?
No, it's compounded into that. So the bottom line is all those rates calculated together.
They're basically all add up to 450. So you got 25, then
right.
you got 100.
All right, I'm sorry. Yeah. They're correct. They will let me know that we have to stick with it.
No, that's no problem.
And that's we're still talking software right now, and the software shouldn't change.
Well, I'll be here next meeting.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Hoffman.
seen that.
Does the council have any discussion on any questions or like more information on your rate to is there a motion?
I make a motion that we accept the recommendation of staff to purchase the Evans and Associates financial software pricing summary with the under the condition if we're going to use off-site or on-site services, and also with the IT cost included.
I'm sorry, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous. Thank you. Number nine, under new business, A, discussion in motion to approve the comprehensive plan update, submit a letter. And I'll read it so the public will know what we have tonight. It's dated April 3rd, 2017, to the South Georgia Regional Commission, 327 West Savannah Avenue, Dallas, Georgia, 31601. In reference to the comprehensive plan update submittal, the City of Quitman has completed an update of its comprehensive plan and is submitting it with this letter for review by the Southern Georgia Regional Commission and the Department of Community Affairs. I certify that we have held the required public hearings and have involved the public in development of the plan in a manner appropriate to our community's dynamics and resources. Evidence of this has been included with our submittal. I certify that appropriate staff and decision makers have reviewed both the regional water plan covering our area and the rules for environmental plan criteria, OCGA 12-2-8, and taking them into consideration in formulating our plan. If you have any questions concerning our submittal, please contact our city manager, Mr. Michael Phelps, at 229-263-4166, or mfeltsquitman@gmail.com. Sincerely, Mayor. Any discussion? Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous. Thank you. B is a motion to approve the 2016 LMA bid. We'll have to select. Reams and Son came in at $150,968.16. And H&H Paving came in at $171,255.10. This is the lowest bid. And does the council want to discuss this, or are they ready to make a decision? Is there a motion?
So moved. We accept Reams as the lowest bidder in the amount of $150,968.16 to complete the 2016 LMA bid.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. All opposed?
But tell the public what that's for.
Oh, LMA.
Yeah, what's the name of it?
The LMA.
2016 LMA.
It's for the paving of the roads that we have selected.
Local maintenance improvement grant. DOT participates with money.
Okay.
And we have a selection of, it's a limited amount of paving on city streets, resurfacing.
Okay.
And part of it is the two repairs on Culpeper Street, north and south, where we had the sewer cave-ins.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll be the region of both of those streets as part of that. And then several other streets in segments around town, but they're scattered all around.
I have a question about those bids. When it wasn't that far off, and one of the company, I think that And that's a company in Brooks County. I mean, I'm saying.
H&F Baby.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Great.
And so, wouldn't that be feasible? I'm just saying, if we use the use his bid, because the money will be turned over for Brooks County. Do that make sense? I'm saying. I know Reams is a big outfit, but here's a person, and they do good work now. Would it be feasible if we could use Head, the one that lives over here in Brooks County, and he have done work for Quitman in Brooks County, and the money that be turned over, we can use that money here instead of taking over the ballot officer. Because he got, in the process, they're going to have utilities and electricity and all that. Would that be for Quitman in Brooks County? Disaster.
Well, that's a 20, so around a $20,000 difference.
Yeah.
That is a big difference. And we are trustees of the city's money.
Yeah.
And that is, unless someone else has any difference of opinion, on the council up here, that's a big difference.
But
this won't be the last time. We have the LME for next year.
But I'm saying, we're going the electricity that they use.
It won't come up to $20,000.
I mean that won't be. It won't be too far off. I'm asking. Wouldn't that be feasible when we work with the people in house? What I'm saying, the money, all that money be in house, and it'll be for the stores and everything, and they're doing the work, but won't we benefit from it? I'm talking about Brooks County as a whole.
I would think
from an ethical standpoint, you just need to go with the lowest bid, correct?
We don't always go with the lowest bid, but we go with the as we just got through discussing that on equipment, not the financial software,
mm-hmm.
that one wasn't the lowest bid, but it was the best choice.
Right.
So, we have dealt with Reams and Sons and Scruggs and Mr. Head, H&H Baby. And go ahead.
I did have a question though. Have we proposed any like advanced bidding, say for example for 2018, based on the average number of blocks that we do on an annual basis? Say if on average we do 15 blocks,
your name, yes, sir.
Brian Dunham,
okay.
Go ahead and bid out, say 12 blocks for 2018, and go ahead and have those bids, you know, in our holster. So if an issue comes up, you know, we don't have to wait a year. You know, in the instance of, say, Culpeper, for example, we'd already have those bids, have them approved, we could pull the trigger and say, hey, we've got one of our 12, you know, that we did the advance bid on, and you guys go ahead and come out and do it. Have we done that or thought about that?
No, but with paving, it's so tied to
cost.
Coal prices and all,
uh-huh.
And to be going over a year, I don't know that you find a lot of companies that would bid out
well
a year.
A lot of times in your bids, you could factor in adjustments for their cost for the raw materials to where, if it did increase the rate.
On this particular project, on an LME project, as Mark, Councilman Devane, tried to explain, each year the Department of Transportation allocates a different funds. Some years you're going to get more money, but you won't know in advance how much you're going to get. So then when we're dealing with an LME project, it's going to be based upon the number of streets that we're going to do is going to be based upon the amount of money that the Department of Transportation is going to be allotting for the
community. I'm just looking from it from a strategic angle
right.
to
well,
save
I understand
the
what
county
saying,
and the city costs.
On this particular project, and usually
yeah.
how we do the bulk of our paving is going to be based around our LME projects.
I guess
it's
I was speaking a little
be,
outside the box.
Then I'm just trying to explain why we do it. Basically, we almost do it kind of a year in advance because we slide
so
the streets
and we do
right, and we do it the year prior, but we're still kind of waiting on state funds to be able to match, because this is a matching.
And we don't never get near what we...
What we expect.
What we need.
Right. Okay, thank you.
All right. All right, y'all.
Okay, all right. Okay. Is there a motion?
We don't have a motion.
Okay, well, all right, that's what I was asking. Okay. We all see the discussion and motion for future repair or demolition of fairground buildings. We had a meeting today. It was posted. And we went and looked at the building in the fairgrounds. And what has the council decided?
I think it's in so disarray that we just need to finish tearing it down, you know. The structure just still left out there. Everything's leaking, you know, there's no... We'd spend a bunch of money trying to repair a whole building.
It's been there a while.
It's been there for a long time. So, I mean, that's what I think, you know, probably. The only thing is, I'd rather turn in some... See... We could put it up for bids, you know, to
tear it down. Yeah.
I think that was kind of a high price to my in my mind. But,
I agree with tearing it down. I think that's the right thing to do. We don't want to invest in a building that's already got leaks.
I don't want somebody kids being out there and it's something falling in.
So I think we go ahead with tearing it down, and I think that's a good idea to have Michael just request bids for complete tear down and haul off everything but the slab. But that's my thoughts on it.
Okay. Would that be going to be two different motions, or that could be it?
If you're ready for a motion, I'll make a motion that we proceed with receiving bids to tear down and haul off the remaining fairground building completely.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Questions, comments? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous. Thank you. D, discussion in motion, the studio business license.
And I apologize. I just realized as soon as you said it, I forgot to get the information from where she moved from. As you all recall, she had just gotten the brand new license. I think it's 103. I think it's 103. She just hopped a couple of locations down.
But we had already approved the application.
The application was already approved, signed, and everything. So, but she's moved shortly after everything was done. So council has in the past waived, if they've just paid for the license, have waived the license fee, and so made this the okay, because it is downtown, the approval for her to basically move from one downtown to the other downtown.
So as Ms. Hudson just said, you already approved this, you just moved. Is there a motion to approve it? Move and waive the fees?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous. Thank you very much. E, the discussion in motion. The Church of God in Unity, Law Day Ad. There isn't anyone here from Foley, is there?
It's Maddie Nellums dropped it off, and I spoke with Mr. Phelps, and of course, bring that before council if they wanted to participate. I think the Law Day was actually today, wasn't it, Chief?
Good.
Law Day was today, wasn't it?
21st.
The 21st. This month, right?
Yep.
This month.
So it's April 30th.
Yeah, that's.
I think that's May the 21st, isn't it?
Well, someone said on the news this morning.
I'll read it. It says, this is from the Foley Church of God in Unity, and it's dated January 20th, 2017. It says, if any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him with my Father, John 12, chapter 26, verse. And it says, to whom it may concern, Foley Church of God in Unity will be honoring all law enforcement from Brooks, Lowndes, Thomas, Cook, and Crawford counties on April the 30th, 2017 at 11:30 p.m., which is Law Day weekend. We are selling ads to do a souvenir book, and we are asking you to purchase an ad to show your thanks for what our officers do for us. The ads are as follows: whole page $100, half page $50, quarter page $25, and patrons $20 or less. Please make checks payable to just contact information at the bottom. So, there, I guess, doing the moment for the 30th. At 11:30. Yeah, that A, I can say it's P. So, what does the council think? Any discussion? Need more information?
Chief, do you have anything in your budget for like marketing or something? Or,
I mean, we think y'all every twice a month.
Why don't we give something like that?
You want to do a half page, Mr. Parker?
Half page?
Okay.
All right. Is
that a motion?
I'll make a formal motion. We do a
half
page.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Questions, concerns, all in favor, raise your hands. Half a page it is, it's unanimous, I'm sorry. Okay. F, discussion in motion, electric rate for project X.
That's great.
I left the sheet at your stations, it should have been there. Got
this sheet?
That's right. Yes. I've been working with ECG, who helps us set our rates and all for new companies or prospects or industries. And Project X is where they're going to be located in the industrial park is actually supposed to be served by Cockwood EMC, but their load is so much that it's bidder's choice. So we get the bid on their load, and Georgia Power will get the bid on their load. So I've been working with ECG of coming up with a competitive bid per kilowatt that we can offer them to see if we can land their electric load. We're already will have their water, sewer, and natural gas. But this is to try to get their electric load. You see there the years 1 through 5, those rates will allow us to recoup our cost of building an electric line out there to the park over 5 years. And then after that, based on the normal industrial rate that would be assigned, then we start making a profit, so to speak. Now, this does cover our cost of providing electricity and all that. It also allows us to recoup the expense of running the line to that facility over 5 years. So, the engineer at Electric City of Georgia and I both have been hashing this over the last several days and come up with this rate structure, and believe it'll be competitive to try to land them. That's our goal anyway. So. If you have any questions about it, I'll try to answer.
Um,
excuse me. What about the risk of the company leaving in 2 years?
That's what I was trying to say. Yeah, that's what I was trying to put it nicely.
Well, unfortunately, we, and I'm not sure why in the past, but we never have built a line out there to serve the industrial park. So at some point in time, our hope is we're going to need it out there. So this line that we have to build out there to them, only a small part of it would only be used by this facility. The rest of it could be used for other facilities out there in the industrial park also.
If that does happen, though, would the answer be to increase the rates to the citizens to cover that cost?
That's not what it's been.
I guess that would always be a possibility, but that would not be ideal. But the thing is, when companies come to locate like this, they have a certain time frame because they're getting incentives from the state and everything on job creation and the number of years they have to stay there. So for them to leave after a year or two, they would have to pay back all these credits that they're getting. So by having it in a 5-year window payback rather than like a 15-year payback, we're increasing our odds that they're going to stay there for our 5 years, because otherwise they're going to have to kick back all these hundreds of thousands of dollars to the state that they're getting
right
for all this. So,
yeah, I know I'm looking at it from the dark side, but yeah, it's still a side that needs to be reviewed.
I mean, there's always a small chance on any, you know, new company or something going out there. But,
thank you.
Well, we have to weigh the ups and downs, pros and cons, and it's, that's just how the machine works.
What are you looking for from us on this spot?
This is
what you want. Because I'd like y'all to approve that before I submit that to the company as our proposal.
Is there a motion?
This is what's recommended by ECG together. Okay.
Based on other CDs and you know what the going rate, so to speak, is and all that kind of stuff, as far as, because they're trying to help us land it. I mean, so we're paying them to do all this analysis.
All right,
I'm ready to make a motion that we accept this or present this, however you want to say that, approve this rate for that project.
Is there a second?
Second.
Questions, concern? All in favor, raise your hands. It's unanimous. Thank you. Number 10, the city manager's report given to us by Mr. Phillips.
Item A, our service delivery strategy. Y'all just approved the submittal letter for our comp plan revision, and our service delivery strategy goes hand in hand with that. That has to be approved by the same date, I believe it's June. I presented it to y'all before, and this is just a reminder that if you have not looked at it or you do have questions, and want to change something or want to discuss something about how it's set up between us and the county, we need to do that by our next meeting, because we need to have it in concrete by the next meeting. So I know the mayor and I have met went over a couple things, and we actually have gotten those changed by the county. And if there's anybody else that has anything, just a reminder, we need to get together or set up a meeting so we can go through those. And item B.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to ask the council.
Okay.
Has everyone had enough time to look at this? I think you've had it for a little while. Okay. So everyone's had enough time. Okay. So
it'll be on the agenda at the next meeting to approve it as it is. So, I mean, unless there's some things that come up between now and then, we have to have a call meeting on it. Otherwise, it'll be on the agenda for April. Item B, T-Splosh is coming back around again. There's a big push with some legislation that has just passed that allows us to, the region, to try to put the T-Splosh back on the ballot for a regional call again. That is, and I talked to Justin about it, the resolution has to come from the county, from each county in the region. You have to have at least 10 that out of our region that agree to start the process to work through T-Splosh and create the committee and all that kind of stuff like we did before. I believe Justin said they were going to pass that last night at their meeting. I had to talk with him to see if they verified that. But and it looks like, and I know there was two other counties that had done it last week, so I'm pretty sure we're going to have the counties to start the process again. So you'll be hearing more information about that in the next coming weeks. It's a pretty aggressive timetable as far as when the meetings start and get the projects together and all, because we have certain time schedules that we have to meet this year to get it on the ballot. We had that. I was in a region that had passed it before I came here. We got a lot of money to pave a lot of streets in the city. In fact, we're talking about LMEG money. I mean, that's a small pot. We're talking about T-Splosh money that can be used for paving streets. I mean, you could be talking about over $100,000 a year in addition to LMEG for us to pay streets with. And that would be huge for small streets like us.
Are you going to actually be talking specifics? Because there were some things that came up last time this went out. One of those things was, how is the money going to be divvied out? And if I remember correctly, they said that they're going to appoint someone like a municipality, like Valdosta, Lyon County, and they would come up with a plan. A no holds bar. I mean, they, whatever they say goes.
Yeah, so I think a lot of, I think last time a lot of the problems was there was some misinformation out there on how it was going to handle and how, and I think that's one reason it failed down here. That's not the way it's handled. It's handled through the state just like a regular SPLOST or something. They collect the money through sales tax money and then issue a check based on your breakdown as far as what you're supposed to get. And it's the formulas are based on road miles and based on population and a lot of things like that. So,
and last time I thought too that it was based on, like, when we were in the early stages, you had specific projects that your intention to use the T-Splosh funds were for.
That's right.
So then, even if the money was going to be allocated through GOSS, you would already know your specific projects and what that specific amount would be. And then they would be aware. So then, whatever the amount was, then it would be allocated based on your project. You wouldn't just get like a blanket amount. I think
right.
So we had like a railroad spur, some different things, and different so many feet of road that we wanted for the city, and then the county had their projects, and then those funds would be then sent down and split based on your project.
Right.
So then you would pick. Well, that was my understanding last time.
Well, that
after the misinformation came out,
the way it's kind of handled is 75% of the big pot of money collected in the region goes for all these specific projects that you have to come up with. And the other 25% of that pot of money is dispersed based on formulas like road miles and all. And that money can be used for any type of transportation need, whether it's repaving, sidewalks, whatever. So it's a two-part thing where you do get monies for specific projects. And one of the meetings I went to, they've learned from this past one to where they've requested from the state to be able to take that 75% and knock it down to like 50%. So that each city or county is getting more money that they can use at their discretion rather than it going into big projects.
Right.
Yeah. So that is a big plus on smaller cities and all like us, to where we can get more money to use where we need it. In some of our streets and stuff like that, rather than in specific meeting projects. So I just wanted y'all to be aware in case you hadn't heard that this is coming back up. And like I said, over the next month, you'll probably hear a lot more and get some emails and all from GMA and some different things. But be looking to get into that again.
It's a 1% sales tax.
Yeah.
Added on to what you already got. So you go to 8% instead of 7%. That's what it is.
Item C, discuss. Yeah, like Elmeg, instead of 30% match, you'd have a 10% match.
Right.
So it does have even better effects.
It's a better deal. Yeah.
The item C, discuss protocol for city proclamations. This is just for some clarification from me and Ms. Bruni. A lot of cities, and I think the way we've, and I've talked to Mr. Gerald about it, the way we've handled proclamations before is, I don't think we have very many. There's no law that says you have to do them a specific way. Usually cities have it in their charter or something that spells out the protocol to do proclamations. Our charter does not. It's not even really mentioned in there. So I know we've had, the mayor has done some proclamations, some of the other council, you know, have done one or two. So I just want, if council wants to direct me and Bruni on how we need to handle proclamations. If it's just any of y'all come to us, if it needs to be spelled out. Like some cities do it to where you submit a request or somebody submits a request saying, I'd like a proclamation because, you know, I'm turning 100 years old or something today. So we would take that and then we would put it on the council and let them decide if that's something the council wants to say, yep, we agree that should be a good proclamation or not. Or if you just want to leave it alone and just let anybody, any of y'all do proclamations. I mean, it don't matter to me. I just want to know how to handle it. So.
Because the only problem I have with let's just let anybody sign it is, if I sign one for Mr. Golden, but I don't sign one for Mr. Durham.
Dunham.
Right. You know, and he's like, you know, why does he want to sign mine? Maybe he wanted me to sign his. Or he can go around and say, well, the mayor didn't sign mine because he doesn't like me or something, you know, and people are trying to figure out, well, what's going on, you know, or let's say I don't sign another proclamation for the next year. Somebody say, no, that's your job. You see, the people think that I should be signing, you know, and that's why, yeah, it would be better if we figure out how we're going to do this thing. Wow. So.
I do proclamations all the time. If someone asks me personally to do a proclamation, it's not a legally binding anything. It doesn't change anything on your calendar that you get from the bank. It's basically a ceremonial thing that I have an opportunity to do because I'm an elected official. So when an individual comes to me, or if the individual comes to Mark, and they have a specific something that they're asking for a proclamation for, if it's dear to Mark, I feel like if he has within his power as an elected official to proclaim whatever it is that he needs to proclaim, because it's not a legally binding anything, it's a ceremonial something. So I think that for me, I try to at least write my own to limit the amount of time that the city council, that the staff has to, you know, spend on it. I do ask them if there's anything that's incorrect or it's not the official way to look it over before printing it. But I think that there are going to be opportunities where people are going to ask because that's their representative and they want that individual to do it because it's something that they have a shared interest in. So I don't understand. I'm missing it. I guess I'm missing why would there need to be any sort of protocol?
Because what happens is everyone's in either District 1 or District 2, and I represent the entire city. So if you're going to do it that way, then I can say, what district are you in? District 1? Go see Mrs. Spark.
No, I don't think that that's what it is, because if a person, which I've done them for people who live in Pete's district, they're not asking because of the district that they live in. They're asking because of the individual, the shared interest that the person has. Even though you're in a district, it still does not define that your power is only limited to the streets that you represent. It doesn't mean that, because it's a ceremonial thing. As your, you know, as the representative for the city council.
You're not necessarily proclaiming something for the city. You're proclaiming it as Nikki Bradley.
Yes, but most city, only the mayor does that.
No, there are other cities where other representatives do it also.
He said the city came from didn't do it. Ms. Bruni said she's never done it. Okay, well, Atlanta has how many people?
I'm saying that still is.
And they got like, two million.
But I'm saying, I mean, I understand. Well, let me ask you this. What, I don't understand what you're saying that because an individual doesn't ask you, then that means that because they ask someone else, then that other person does not have a ceremonial right to sign a proclamation.
Okay, let's go to the proclamation you just did at the thing.
Right.
Okay, I was there. But you read a proclamation that was supposedly, you were the spokesperson for the city.
I was a spokesperson for myself. That
it has a letterhead for it, and it has every council member on there, and it has the staff on there, and it's an official letterhead.
It does.
And guess who signs it? Not the mayor, because guess what? I don't like this person.
You weren't proclaiming anything. I was, and I was proclaiming it at the interest, at the request of Jay Green. He asked me, Ms. Bradley, I have a special guest coming to town, and well, let's just say this. He, in the function, he acknowledged you as the mayor. You stood up, you waved your hand, and then when in my proclamation, I proclaimed it by my power as mayor pro tem of the city of Quitman, which is my role, which is my right, which is my ceremonial duty. I can do that. I didn't say on behalf of the city council of Quitman. I said on behalf of me, myself, mayor pro tem, I'm proclaiming with the seal of the city, which I have the right to use, just like everyone else has the right to use because I'm an elected official, to use the city seal. Everyone whose name is on the letterhead, Bruni sends out letters on the letterhead signed by herself without anybody's approval if we're going to say that it was on the city letterhead. If Ms. Smart had a letter that she needed to go out in an official capacity and it needed to be on city letterhead, she has the right to use the city letterhead without anyone giving her approval to use it as long as the staff has given it to her. So I don't understand the confusion in that. Jay asked me, he acknowledged you, no one disrespected you in any way. He asked me to do it and I did it. I didn't include your name, I didn't include anyone else's name, I only used my name. So I don't understand why there's a problem with that or what you had to do with that anyway.
Oh, I just wouldn't think that day-to-day business using city letterhead would be the same as a proclamation.
Why would you not think that?
Because a proclamation is completely different than day-to-day business that Bruni would do.
How is that any different?
It just is.
It's in my responsibility as, it's in my day-to-day duties as a council member to do whatever I want to with, if I'm proclaiming something, that's in my day-to-day responsibility as an election official.
You can make a proclamation.
I'm going to do some more research on it because
You can research all you want. The city manager has already said that it's not in our charter that determines who can do it and who cannot.
Oh, I just researched because I'm curious.
Go ahead.
Anybody can make a proclamation. And I don't think, as long as she doesn't say she, I'm using you as an example, I won't say that on behalf of the city of Quitman. And if that's not used, it's almost like a free speech issue. I can make a proclamation tomorrow. If someone asked me to do it, any of us could. The mayor can. But if you use the city equipment as part of it.
And to also further say, Mr. Mayor, if it's about, is it just about the proclamation? Because I'm sometimes, in my official capacity as an elected official, I met last week without anyone's approval, with the U.S. Congressman. And I met with him, and I discussed, and I lobbied with him. And I used my title as mayor pro tem, and I discussed different issues with him, and I didn't have to get anybody's approval to do that. And I was contacted by the U.S. Congressman through his office.
Can I answer?
Yes.
Our charter states that you are only the mayor pro tem in my absence. In my absence. So how do you put yourself in a position, take the power from me, and then you have more power than I even have because you go out and meet with congressmen when you were only elected as a city council member. You were only, if I was not here today, you would be sitting right here as the mayor pro tem in my absence. I'm just saying this is what our charter says. So, but do you have something you'd like to say, Mr.
Hold on, Mr. Ryan. Mark, did you and Pete, were you went to, where did we all go when you all met?
Okie Pinocchi.
And didn't you all meet with representatives there?
And the mayor did as well.
Okay, so I'm saying, I don't understand what's the difference in that. I'm just saying that I still have, there's nothing, my role as a council member, my title as mayor pro tem does not change when I'm apart from here. When I go to GMA conference or when I go to anywhere, my name tag still says mayor pro tem. It has nothing to do with my capacity of when I come in here in the meeting, facilitating the meeting. It's still my title. It's the title that was given to me by the majority of this council. It doesn't change that.
I just like to say, I cover a lot of cities in short form, probably to move on. If it's not in the charter, it may be something y'all may want to consider putting in the charter.
I had a question real quick. Have we done any research on when the Zika virus is going to hit Brooks County?
That's not on the agenda.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's eventually going to hit at some point. But it's kind of a good thought as far as education goes.
Well, is that it?
Yes, well, item D, we had added the Red Cross proclamation. Well, I mean, item C, I don't want to be stuck in the middle of something.
I'm just reading the charter. It says section 13, and it's under the charter. It says chairman pro tem. The chairman or the board of commissioners shall appoint one of the commissioners chairman pro tem, who shall exercise the routine duties of the chairman in case of the chairman's absence or inability to act for any reason. And I'm just reading from the charter.
Oh, you know, we've changed that since then. That's outdated, actually. And the newest charter amendment says that I have equal authority as you,
okay,
to be technical.
I did some OCGA research, right, and the OCGA says that you cannot take my powers away unless it goes before the Georgia General Assembly.
This is really even beside the point, because I was not acting in your absence. I was acting well within my authority as a councilmember.
But again, we have since changed
that charter amendment.
We have a American Red Cross proclamation, and who's going to sign it?
You can sign it.
All right, I'll sign it.
Okay, I have a question. At the beginning of the statement, it was said that a proclamation can be requested from any one of you on the council, right? So, like, if I ask anybody on the council for a proclamation, you can write it for them?
I can do that. If you want a proclamation from me stating that you've done something, and we recognize that as a great and meritorious thing, I can write you a proclamation. Or anybody can. You can have anybody write you a proclamation.
Okay, so you said somebody asked you to write them a proclamation.
Right.
What is the big deal?
And if you come and want a proclamation from the city, that's when, to me, it comes before this group. And the city does a proclamation. But as an individual, you can all day long do proclamation. It's a free speech issue to me. You know, I can proclaim tomorrow National Pizza Day. I can. That's fine. But if you want it proclaimed by the city of Quitman, then in that instance, you come before the board.
And probably have to be voted on.
And then we would proclaim it.
So it's this issue that we're discussing now was not an issue that needed to be brought around up to the city, right?
It could be to get clarification.
It could have been, but it wasn't.
And I understand what Mr. Phelps, the city manager, is saying. He's unsure
what we want. And I think the answer to that may be, this is me talking out loud, that if someone wants a proclamation from the city, be it a group wanting support or you know, something like that, then it should come before this council, and we'll vote on it and sign one.
But in the past, we have made that decision with clarity that if it was going to be submitted to the council as a group, then all individuals on the council would sign collectively. We voted on that in the past. Yes. So these are two separate things. Right. If a private individual comes to you, they've gone to your church or whatever, yeah, and they want you to do it, you have every right to do it.
I believe so.
Exactly.
So that clears everything up.
There's already a policy in place. You've already discussed that. If it comes before us, like this one that you're about to sign, which nobody has a big deal about, there's only one line there for you to sign, we should say send it back and make them get four more slots so that we can all sign according to what we voted on a couple of years ago. But we don't have a problem with that because you can sign it. Or do you want to follow that version?
What do you want me to tell Red Cross?
I'm saying you're saying that we need to have a rule. I'm saying there's already one thing.
You're not talking to you, Mr. Mayor, okay? I was talking to you, Mr. Mayor.
Well, I got a chief.
What?
Chief.
Yes.
I'm telling someone to not talk in this session. They weren't given permission to speak. And that is Mr. Mayor. And he said he's talking to me anyway. So, if we have any more disturbances,
you want a motion on that proclamation?
Yes,
I'll make the proclamation that Mr. Mayor, you signed the Red Cross proclamation.
Is there a second?
Second for that.
Questions, concerns? All in favor, raise your hands. Thank you. It's unanimous. All righty. Is that it for you?
That's it for me.
All right. Roll number 11, the city clerk's report, which will be given to us by Mrs. Bruma Hudson.
I spoke with Ms. Doris Miley. She has a new community outreach. She does youth programs and things like that, but she wanted me to make sure council is aware that she will have open panics. So she's invited all council, all city members, all city citizens, finance, said anybody, please come and see. She's very excited about it. That's what this is.
Thank you.
Good.
You probably already received his email, but I was not going to share the cell phone numbers because those are your personal cell phone numbers. And I was not going to share those with the Board of Elections unless you give me the okay. If you do not, and I made them aware that not all of our council members have cell phones to text to. So he's going to have to find a different way to communicate. So that's what that is. If you all are okay, if you're not okay, if you want to talk about it, whatever you would like to do, I'll let
you can give them mine. I've already texted them back or emailed them, but they didn't.
Okay.
I haven't received anything yet, so you can give them my information.
I've already given them mine.
Ms. Bradley, you have two. You can say. And I know Mr. Pete, you don't.
I don't have one.
That's what I told him. Ms. Moore, are you good?
I already talked to him.
Okay. That was that. The other one was I wanted to make everybody aware that the GMA Annual Convention registration went underway this morning. As always, it was just one of those mad moments. I forwarded all of the confirmations to each and every one of you. For those that did not get the class that was requested, or the hotel have put a request in for to be put on the wait list and periodically check into that. So just want to make everybody aware of that. And that's all I had.
Thank you very much. Okay, we're going to be going into executive session for the discussion of land purchasing. And once we're done, you can come back in, or you just leave. It's up to you. But is there a motion to open up the executive session?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, raise your hands. Yeah. All in favor, raise your hands. That's unanimous.
Thank you. Brooks County.